Field lighting system? Okay, 4, 3. Hello, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to the video meetup today. It's presented by Community Television of Santa Cruz County and Satellite Co-working Center, Santa Cruz Satellite. That's a joint venture that's Community Television's way of managing to continue to thrive in the age of funding constraints. We have this wonderful space that is available for meetups like this. We have offices. We have a screening room. Hopefully you all got to see the screening room. We have edit suites. Hopefully you got a chance, or you will get a chance, to see the 360 video editing software in there later. We have a full production studio, and we have a whole lot of rental equipment right here that's available for anyone who would like to rent it. Just need a credit card. And tonight we're going to talk about something new, some new equipment we have, and a whole new way of creating video, 360 video, or immersive video. And we have with us an expert, Joe Goldin, who works for Impact Creative here in Santa Cruz. He is an expert in VR and creating 360 video, and I'm going to take it over to Joe.
Thanks. Great. Thank you so much, Keith. And first of all, thank you to Satellite and CTV for making this possible. I'm really happy to be here tonight. Just a little bit about my background. I started in the virtual reality, kind of augmented reality world at the UC, doing research in a high-level perception lab. So I originally approached it from a very psychological, medical standpoint. But my passion growing up was always gaming and media, and I knew that's what I wanted to do. So I was able to, through a couple of friends, find an internship at Impact Creative and eventually begin working there part-time doing 360 video stitching. And then from there, I've expanded. I work full-time as their technologist. So I'm responsible for research and development of emerging technologies and finding ways that we can integrate those into our current workflows, as well as expand the things that we can do. So in the last couple of years, we've transitioned away from being just a standard 2D production company to more of an emerging technology media agency. And we've gotten into the VR world maybe 3 years ago when we did a 360 piece for Vice. So I'll talk a lot tonight about the technical side of things and some of the challenges that we're facing. And then after that, take some questions and we can talk about some creative things as well. To begin with, 360 video, there's a lot of misnomers and a lot of misconceptions about what 360 video even means. First of all, 360 is not VR video and it's not VR. So the biggest misconception and what a lot of people don't understand is that a video is a pre-rendered, it exists, you know, there's no live processing that's going on, it's going to play from start to finish. Whereas a virtual reality experience is more like a video game. So you have control over the camera, you know, things are happening in real time, and the computer has to render that in real time. That's why most of the experiences that you'll see nowadays are pretty low end. They look like games from 5 or 10 years ago. What this means is that 360 video, and I'll talk a little bit more about the format, the equirectangular format, and how we represent that as video files, but 360 video is multi-platform. You can watch it on your phone, on a tablet, on a VR headset, you know, pretty much any device that exists nowadays. On a phone, you'll see it in the magic window sort of view where you can move around something that gives you a view to another world. In a tablet or in a VR headset, it's more of a first-person view, and this introduces a lot of really interesting psychological constraints. First of all, one of the big rules with VR video is you don't move the camera, and that's challenging a lot of the time for filmmakers, and I'll get into some of those problems again later. But an important thing to remember throughout this is that 360 video is its own format. It exists alongside VR, but it is very different. So the technical name for the most common way that we look at 360 video is equirectangular. And the easiest real-life example of this that you've all seen 100 times, millions of times, is a world map. It's when we take a sphere and we stretch it out onto a rectangle. And you'll notice on this is a recent piece that we shot in New York. The left side and the right side of this image are the exact same point in space, and it's the same for the top and bottom. So what happens is your computer or your cell phone takes that media and wraps it around a sphere and turns it into a 360 video that doesn't look so crazy like this does. To give you a little more perspective on that, you'll notice that each of those four areas has a left, right, front, back. The camera sees in every direction. So again, there's some really interesting problems that that introduces, but it allows you to give the viewer much more control, in fact, pure control over what they're looking at. Another popular format, which I'll bring up because it's really essential to the post-process pipeline for 360 video, is a cube map. And it's the same principle. We're taking what is a sphere, and we're stretching some things out and mapping it onto a cube. So it's all representations of 3D shapes, and then we're kind of moving those around. So every camera that we have right now that shoots 360 video starts by shooting 2D video, traditional 2D video. And every camera that we have, for the most part, is a multi-camera system. So you need multiple cameras and multiple lenses to capture enough of a picture to be able to put that together. It's the same principle we've been using in panorama photography for decades. We've had 360 been around. It's been around now for long enough that we have three different tiers of cameras. We have consumer, prosumer, and professional. And there are some very, very big differences between them all. Even the consumer cameras at the moment are somewhat expensive, considering it's such a new emerging technology. And the quality differences are pretty incredible. The most popular consumer cameras nowadays are something like the Ricoh. This is the Theta S model. So you're shooting 30 frames per second. You're getting a 2K image out. What that means is that it's really only suitable for photography or viewing on a phone. Because you have so much more space that you need to show with a 360 format, when you shoot something at normal definition or even 4K, you don't have enough pixels to really give yourself that beautiful image when you wrap it around a sphere. Beyond that, because of the interesting warping that happens in a 360 image, you have to be really cognizant of where your cameras are looking. The center of the camera, because most of them use fisheye lenses, are going to have a higher quality image. In the prosumer world, first of all, this is an image taken with that previous Nikon camera you see on the right there. What you'll notice, you'll see the two stitch lines. Since this is a two-camera system, there's going to be two points in the image where straight up and down, the camera has to peel everything together and combine it. And what happens is, as objects get further away with a fisheye lens, the warping on those objects starts to change, and so things don't quite match up. And it's more apparent in this next photo, but you'll see the rocks out in the distance near the front and back car tires. Those look great, and they match up perfectly, and the lighting is good. But as you get closer and closer, you see the lighting changes, and that's because the cameras were both exposing differently. You know, one was facing the underneath of a car, and the other was facing into the sun. So these are challenges that we face with the professional-level cameras, too. Moving up to prosumer helps. So this is you see the Sphere Cam on the left and the GoPro Omni, which CTV has over here on the right. Both of those are multi-camera systems. They still have to deal with stitch lines, but because you have more cameras, you have more image, more quality, it's easier for the computer to figure out what it needs to do to kind of fit those together. But for every camera, you introduce another pair of stitch lines. So now you're worried about six stitch lines as opposed to just two. And this is something that happens even up until the professional level. So on the left, that's a rig you can rent from a company down in LA. To even shoot, you need a really, really powerful server that can intake all of the 4K raw streams that are coming from those cameras. So they'll set that thing up, and then right beneath that, there'll be a massive computer that needs to be plugged in. It's not really a great solution for on-the-go shooting. And on the right, you'll see three red cameras, which are very expensive. They're hard to work with. And the big issue is that as you take those, because the cameras are so huge, we get great quality, but your lenses are now so far apart from each other, your stitch line issue is much, much worse, and that convergence issue is also worse. So what you'll notice with some of the cinema quality and Hollywood level 360 videos that have been produced on these systems is that your actors never get very close. The scenes are very static. A lot of things don't move. And right now, these are challenges that we just kind of have to work around. The Omni, and that's the Nokia Ozo on the right. The Omni is a $5,000 camera. The Ozo is an $80,000 camera. But their quality is, depending on what you're doing, almost the same. The Ozo has some really interesting stitching issues. And you'll see that back end there where that orb comes off, the attachment piece. there's a hole there. The camera can't see that part. So when you produce a piece with that, you have to either paint that with a motion graphics artist in post. And basically, at whatever level you're at in 360 video, the cameras just aren't quite there yet. And what this means is that we've had to be really, really creative in the way that we shoot content. Moving on to the workflow, we have six steps, essentially, and they're very traditional. Shoot, ingest, stitch, edit, refine, and publish. And we'll begin with shooting. So pre-production and planning, I would argue, is more important for 360 video than any other format that exists. The number of challenges that exist in not just capturing footage, so that means making sure that your actor blocking is not going to cross a stitch line in a way that makes someone's head disappear or seem like they're merging into someone else. It also means making sure that one camera isn't pointing straight into the sun so that you get equal exposure all around. It also means that you're taking into account the environment, the audio in your environment, and whether or not you want normal 2D audio or spatialized audio, which can make for a more immersive experience, but means that you have to put another audio pipeline together just to produce that. Certain things like camera positioning are really important. So first of all, everything is in the shot. If you're shooting in 360, you can't use a set unless it's a full 360-degree set. You can't light unless you can find creative ways to hide your lights such that the camera can't see them. And what we find is that because everything is wide angle, you need people to be very close to the camera in order to get an intimate relationship formed between the viewer and the characters. If you're doing any kind of piece where someone is talking to the camera or you're following any kind of characters, they almost need to be so close that you're going to have issues with stitch lines. So what this means is blocking your scenes in such a way that people move in front of when they're close to the camera, they're directly in front of a lens. But as they move away, they move away from the camera and cross somewhere else. So there's a lot that goes into just conceptualizing the scene. As I said before, stitch lines are probably the biggest issue that we deal with. First of all, your tripod or your monopod is always going to be in the shot. So that's something that you have to consider, either taking plates of your environment beforehand and kind of compositing that in post, ignoring it. If you look at most 360 content out there, there's not a single bit of stabilization or masking that's been done to it, and people still really enjoy the content. So all of these issues aren't reasons to stop shooting. They're actually, I think, really great creative limitations that cause you to think in new, different ways. And what's really interesting is that camera position and height hugely affects the viewing experience. Even in the magic window format where you have an iPhone or a tablet that you're using and you're not wearing a headset, because you've given the viewer control over their camera angle, they feel like they have a lot more agency, and so they're a lot more connected with the piece, which is good and bad. Good in the sense that if you're head height with another person, you're going to feel like you're on the same level as that person. So for interview pieces, or if you have a host leading you through a certain area explaining things, it's an amazing way to kind of get that connection with somebody, and you can allow them to explore the scene while the host leads them around, and they have a center focal point that they can always return to. But if your camera is 2 inches too low or 2 inches too high, it's going to be a really strange experience for the viewer, and you almost can't watch it in VR, depending on what your height is as a person. There was a very interesting study that came out that showed that if you were to put a camera in the middle of a classroom of students, and a camera at the back of the classroom of students, and a camera at the desk, both of the positions in the classroom, so sitting at the desk or standing up, they felt natural and people loved watching it. But when you were at the back of the classroom, people felt like they were almost voyeuristic, as if they were a fly on the wall. And because there wasn't any character in the scene who acknowledged them, most people wouldn't watch the video and quit halfway through. So there's a lot, even viewing in the magic window format, there's a lot of psychological effect that goes on giving the user that agency. So now you've shot your content, you worked through all the issues, you hope that you have something good. Another problem is that you can't actually view anything on camera. Because the camera sees everything, you can't be there to direct your actors. And you can't view your footage until you get home and stitch it on your computer. So it's one of those things where you really want to hope that you have a couple of days to shoot it and a couple of chances to get the shot. But about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, this means that you'd get back home, you'd have 6 or 10 little micro SD cards that you have to take off. You've got to match up, shot one on camera one, shot one on camera two, for your 40, 50 shots that you did during the day, put all of those in separate folders, import that. It was just an absolute nightmare. And that was if your GoPro didn't stop recording and you lost a camera halfway through the shot. So thankfully, with things like the Omni or the Ozo, most any consumer level camera that's out today, there's some kind of automatic import utility. So you plug it all in, you hit go, and it starts to do its thing. Honestly, this has been one of the most important innovations that we've made, and it seems like something small, but it's a really incredible tool to be able to kind of, this process used to take us days, and now it takes hours, basically. Once you have your footage imported, the Omni tool takes care of making an initial stitch. So like I said before, what's going on behind the scenes is that every camera is overlapping a little bit. And what the software does is it looks for individual points that are in those overlapping areas, and it says, oh, I know this here matches up to this here, and I can kind of warp everything together. What this means is you really want to choose, you want to use your environment to your benefit. So you can orient the camera in such a way that there are interesting artifacts on those stitch lines. And like I said, with the Omni software, it's really a one-click process now. So as long as the camera was set up correctly, you can hit go and have a finished 360 piece in the end. The software that GoPro recently purchased is called Color Autopano Video Pro. And this works with their Autopano photography software. So that's been out for a couple of years. They're an industry leader in the area. Essentially, you create a template still panorama, and that gets applied to every frame in your video. And you can choose, you know, you can cut clips up and choose as many of those template panoramas as you want. But it means that you're choosing a one-size-fit-all approach for the video, which doesn't always work out. So what I like to recommend is, especially with a system like the Omni, you shoot, you import, you make sure that your horizon lines are correct. So let's see here. If the camera is at an angle, when you go to view that 360 video, the entire world will be at an angle. So really the first step is kind of correcting that, making sure that you have a basic stitch. The ground is flat, everything looks okay. And that's where you move into the editing process. So I will get into the Autopano software a little bit more in a few minutes here. But what's important to notice, and this is that horizon issue I was talking about, editing is just like editing a traditional video. You throw it into Premiere. There's a little button that you can click that allows you to view it in that magic window mode. There's an offset effect, which lets you rotate the video. So if you want someone to start looking at a certain point, you can rotate it so that's in the center of the screen. What this means is that, you know, if you're familiar with traditional video editing, there are definitely some new challenges that come with 360. Directing the user's attention is the hardest part, and a lot of that comes from actor blocking and motion in the scene. But it's really easy if you understand basic software that's out there now to kind of get into editing pieces together, which is great. Once you have that stitch put together, this is what one of our projects looks like. You can come in and view it, play through, browse in that magic window mode. I'll just touch really quickly. The post pipeline for motion graphics and special effects in 360 is kind of a whole nother world. And I could speak for hours and not really touch the surface. Because of that interesting warping issue that's going on, it's really hard to just throw a graphic in. You can't put a title in or an image without kind of warping it to that view. So there's software like Skybox Studio, which kind of automatically does this for you. But it means that you're now working in an After Effects composition with six virtual cameras that represent every real camera that you had on your rig. You have to re-render every clip if you put any kind of change in. So the post process there is really, really long. It's tedious, but there's some really interesting things. Again, it's one of those areas that's improving daily. So give it some time and it'll get better. After you've put an edit together, you can come back into the Autopano software and refine. So there's three really important things. There's your horizon, which I spoke about before. There's your stitching. So that's the actual merging of the images together. A term you'll hear a lot is ghosting, which is as you cross over a stitch line, your hand will kind of disappear. And what's happening is that the software is choosing one part of one camera over another part of another camera. Very quickly here. So this is a short GIF of what the software actually looks like, and they have it set up in the edit station in the front. essentially you get to view each camera individually. You can go in and look at where it's positioned and move it around. Typically, that's not a great idea because the software is better at doing it than we are. What's most useful is the matching points. So, like I said before, it's trying to recognize similar points in every area, kind of bring those together. What you can do is go into the point editor and drag and drop on a certain area that exists in two pictures, and it'll magically find these points and improve your stitch. So I believe I show that here momentarily. Those are all the center, those points that you just saw were the centers of each lens on each camera. And those red dots were pre-existing points that it matched up. So what you'll notice is this is the default stitch straight out of the software. Only a small area of the image has actually been matched up. So what's really great is once you've put your edit together and you've spent most of your time working on the creative, you can come back and really focus in on the few areas that you need to improve in your stitch. And you don't spend, you know, hours and hours, days improving every little stitch for the footage that you're not going to end up using. Moving on to the publishing workflow, with the recent updates to the Adobe software, there's a little checkbox that you can click that will export your video with VR metadata. So when you upload it to a site like Facebook or YouTube, everything works automatically. It processes in about an hour, and the video will show up as a 360 video. And there are a lot of different smaller sites that are popping up. VRidio is one. There's a couple of different private companies like Jaunt or NextVR who have their own viewing platforms. But Facebook and YouTube are where we are seeing the real views. And both Facebook and YouTube have the best streaming support. You know, it's 4 to 6 times as much content as an HD video. So even just streaming that to your computer is a challenge. And they have the best spatialized audio support, which means that if you were watching a 360 video of a piano and you turn to the left, the sound of the piano would stick with that piano. So technically, they're the best places. Facebook is an incredible place to get views. We did a piece for Vice that was on their page for 5 days, and in those 5 days, we had 5.5 million views. There are other pieces that were up at the same time, maybe had 1 to 2 million. So what's really interesting with the 360 content, and I would honestly recommend, it's great to go out and shoot 360 video as if you're shooting a 2D video, because you can post it online, someone can watch looking forward the entire time and have that same experience. You get a little experience of watching a 2D video or shooting a 360 video. And as the consumer is scrolling through their Facebook, that video is still changing its view in the background. So a lot of people will see it and say, oh, I've never seen this kind of thing before. What is this? Or it catches their eye. So just creating content in 360 versus a 2D format, even if it's the same content you would have shot otherwise, there can be benefit to that. The Monterey Bay Aquarium, I don't know if it will play this way here. There we go. This is a great example of a 360 video done well. This was shot on an Nokia Ozo, so if you look very closely behind, you can find some areas where there are stitch lines.
Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in to DNews today. I'm Trace. I'm here at Land's End. It's at the very edge of San Francisco, and it's a beautiful place to come and see whales breaching or watch seals.
Immediately they introduce you with someone who is guiding you through the process. So like I said, the hardest part about directing for VR is directing your viewer's attention. If you have an actor or a host who is literally directing your viewer's attention throughout the entire piece, it's a really great way to get information across. And for explanatory pieces or documentaries, it's a great way to allow the viewer to focus on what they're interested in while they're listening to someone speak. So like I said, I focused a lot on the technical. We've been really experimenting with the creative side of things, so I'd love to take some questions about that, if anyone has any. Yes. Absolutely. So,
how is that done? Mostly on a pole or a stand, and you just stand back.
Right. So the question was how we position the camera and whether it's a pole or a stand. We actually prefer to use the thinnest monopod that we can. So, DJI, the quadcopter drone company, they make a really portable, very tiny monopod that's great. It's super thin. That's really the best option. But when we shoot 360, there's no way to monitor. And if you can see the camera can see you. So what we tend to do is direct our actors as best we can before the scene and leave the room. There's some really interesting stories where, you know, even if you have a light gaffer, you know, out of a building, if he can be seen through the window by the camera, it's going to be picked up. So there's, it's really hard to hide lighting and audio. Those are some of the biggest issues. What we found really helps is to just consider the camera as a person. It's the best way to kind of visualize, first of all, that head height issue. So where you place the camera is really going to affect the viewer. If you consider that just to be a person who's observing the scene, you know, where would you want to stand as a viewer? That's a great way to look at it.
What about iris and focus?
Iris and focus?
Yeah.
You have no real control. So on the higher end systems, we can do ND filters. So if you're shooting with three reds, you can customize that, but it introduces some problems in post. And really, the cameras are what we're going to see improve the most over the next few years. So one of my favorite behind-the-scenes stories is that issue. So there was a crew shooting in a great, beautiful church. There were windows everywhere. You couldn't be outside without being seen by the camera. So every single person who was doing anything outside, whether it was lighting or miking, had to lie on the ground wearing camouflage and hide behind bushes. People hid in bushes. There's really no way around it. So you can do things like, you know, shoot half of your scene and be on the other side of the camera and then shoot the reverse half. But if you have any kind of movement over those two stitch lines, it's not going to match up. You're going to be rotoscoping for days and it won't really look great. Because of those strange warping issues, you never get one stitch that's quite like another. So even if your camera never moves and you're starting and stopping recording remotely, you really can't jump cut without the viewer knowing. So it's definitely a challenge. Yes.
So as far as the editing program goes, if you're working with a camera that only has like two lenses on it, doesn't need necessarily a lot of stitching, is the editing program still beneficial in some ways? Would you still recommend it?
Right. So the question is whether if you're working with a two-camera system versus a 6 or 10-camera system, do you still need that editing software? And what the distinction that needs to be made is that there's stitching software and there's the editing software. So once the video has been stitched, you can edit it in any program that supports video editing, really. You know, Final Cut or Premiere Pro, they all have plugins that enable viewing, so you can work in what you want. The issue is that you always need some kind of stitching software. So the consumer cameras usually come with something. It won't be on the level of auto panel color, but you can still import that footage into auto panel color. There are benefits to using two cameras versus six. You only have two stitch lines. And you really, you know, if you have a building where there are two walls on the side of your scene, that it works great. For traveling, it's lightweight. It's really easy. You don't have to worry about six GoPros sitting on a monopod that you can't be near. So for that shoot we showed some pictures of, we had to have people on every side of the area we were in New York because we were worried about someone running by and just grabbing it and being gone. So. And to that extent, the lower end cameras you don't have to worry about as much because they cost a lot less. So you can be a little more creative and a little more experimental.
Have you tried this on a drone for aerial photography?
So have we tried it on a drone? It's something we're working on. We have tried it. It works, but there's a lot of issues that you introduce. So the micro vibrations that are caused in the camera body really mess with not only the cameras but the stitching. Movement, again, is a big issue. If you're shooting a piece that's meant for a VR headset, it's going to be different than a piece that's meant for a tablet. And the same goes vice versa. So drone pieces in a VR headset, unless you have, there's a few techniques you can use, but for the most part, it's going to make people sick because they're moving, they think they're moving while they're not. That being said, a drone piece in 360 on your phone might be fantastic. So the other issue is stabilization. Unless you have a gimbal that works hanging off a copter that can hold a 360 rig 5 or 10 feet down from the copter, which is a really hard thing to accomplish, it's a big challenge. Yes?
What if indoors you hung it from the ceiling or outdoors you hung it from a line, like mm-hmm. clothesline idea?
Absolutely. So if we've, the question was if we've hung it rather than putting it on a monopod. And absolutely, something we did in that New York piece was hang it from trees in Central Park so that you get this beautiful look down at a couple who are doing snow angels in the leaves. And typically people don't look up. People look down a lot, especially as that's, you know, where you're holding your phone, you kind of rest looking down. So it's a great way to hide shots if you can. I definitely recommend it if you can, absolutely. Yes?
Can you speak a little bit to the issue of parallax and stitching and how you deal with stitching objects that are in the foreground?
Sure. So something I didn't touch on is the distinction between 3D 360 and 2D 360. So it gets a lot more complicated and there's a lot more technical issues, so it might be better for another talk, but 3D 360 is 360 video where you have a 3D image. And this means you're either shooting with twice as many cameras or you're shooting with something like 20 cameras and having another server beneath it that's doing some crazy math to kind of figure out what those in-between shots would look like. It's not really doable at the moment unless you're working with someone like Google and they have two cameras available. So it's very new. But parallax is still an issue that we have in 2D 360. So if I go back to one of the initial slides, which showed that Nikon Key Mission 360 photo. If you look at the bottom of the image, you'll see that the rocks don't really align at all. And that's because of the fisheye, it's not a rectilinear image. So as you get further away, both directly in front of the camera and also left and right from the camera, the images warp in different ways. So the best way to get rid of the issue is to keep people 3 to 5 feet away from the camera at all times. Again, that means that you can't really get close and interpersonal shots. So for those kind of shots, that's when you would focus on really considering how you're going to block the scene and really focusing on where you're going to put the camera. We use Naga arms or Israeli arms as a way of kind of tilting the camera when it's on the monopod and shifting where those stitch lines are. It means you're going to have a little more work in post, kind of fixing the horizon, but it helps a lot.
Can you show them the vice thing you did?
Absolutely. So this was a piece. That would be an issue, wouldn't it? Let's see here. Great. So you'll notice right behind his helmet, there's a very slight stitch line. And so we placed him there to kind of counteract that. Like I said before, if you know where those stitch lines are, you can really work to get around them. A lot of the time, they're not an issue that we have to worry about. It's really when people get close. We shot this with Kaj Larson. So in the top right, you'll see the indicator that shows where forward is when the video starts, and we start on him. He is the first voice you hear, and he's the first person you see. So it really helps give the users a point of reference, and he's always in the center of the shot. So on Facebook, that means that anyone can look at that little icon and immediately know where he is and browse to him. This was a really, really complicated scene to stitch, mostly because there were some people very close to the camera who move around. And you can see a little bit of stitch lines at the bottom there as he moves through. Another thing you'll notice is our DP Philip in every shot in this film. It's really hard, especially on a plane, to get that monopod to stick still. So he had to be there holding it. And we did a lot of post stabilization to try and get it that wobble effect to disappear. But it's really, really challenging.
Where's the user? it where you're pushing the record button? On tablet or?
So with the GoPro Omni, you can press the record button on the camera and walk away. Or if you have the Wi-Fi remote or the app, you can connect to one camera. You can't stream any of the views, but you can record and stop from that. So you do have the ability to do remote. That being said, I don't recommend it. Even though the Omni is great, it still has bugs. They're actively working on updating the software and the firmware. Sometimes you come back and you find out that your camera turned off halfway through the scene and you just have to restart. So it's worthwhile to check every time.
So in this scene, when you are looking up, where is the camera?
So we had two crews for this. While one was up in the plane with a 6-camera rig, we had a crew on the ground with a 10-camera rig. So this was before the days of the Omni. So we had 16 different GoPros that were all individually numbered. So for every scene that we had either 6 or 10 video files. Most of the time, that because it's a GoPro, those get split up. So we had 30 to 40 different video files that we had to organize for one shot. Just stitching this piece took a couple of weeks. With the Omni, it would have taken a couple of days. So things are improving very quickly. Thank you. Oh.
Thank you, Joe. I appreciate that great talk, and we recorded it.
Great.
That's good. So that's Joe's going to be here for a little while. If you want to ask him questions, feel free. We have people in all the different rooms to show you the various equipment if you want. Hang around for a while, learn about what's going on here, and thank you for coming. Thank you.